treat time. The chickens love the end of August. That's a tomato. No, you don't. You're a nosy little bugger, aren't you? You're messing up my whole thing. I had everything all staged up here. Rascal sticks his nose in it and it goes to pot. These actually smell a little bit fermented. I'm not eating these. These are cherry tomatoes, by the way. I picked them a few days ago because I wanted to get them off the plant. Rapunzel, tomato plant, by the way, is what produced all of these cherry tomatoes. I picked about one heaping bowl, a big old bowl. This is about a couple days worth of picking for me when it comes to the Rapunzel. And as you saw recently, she's loaded. She's a loaded plant. Now what I'm doing is I'm saving seeds from these. I have more than enough tomatoes. I have a big pile of them in the kitchen to eat. I have a lot of them in the freezer stored away. I have them canned for sauce. I still have Boxcar Willie, the big beefsteak tomato plant, cranking out tomatoes right and left. So I have more than enough tomatoes. I'm sending some cherry tomatoes in with Mike the dishwasher to Walmart. He works at Walmart in the auto repair, you know, where they put brakes and stuff on cars, the tire and lube department. And I send in eggs with him to give to all the guys there to take home. They appreciate it. There's no charge, of course. All I ask is that they return the egg carton so that I can fill them up, because I don't have egg cartons. So as long as they bring in egg cartons, they got all the free eggs they can possibly stand. And they really do appreciate that. And that's one thing I do like. I don't need the money. It's just a few dollars anyway, so it really wouldn't make a difference. But what I do enjoy is that people appreciate this. And that's a good thing. Now the chickens, they do appreciate the tomatoes. Some folks have said that, you know, that's a waste of tomatoes to feed them to your chickens. I really don't think of it as a waste, because they're my pets. They produce eggs. They produce the manure that fuels this garden. You think about it, they are one of the biggest contributors to my garden. Without their manure, I couldn't make the kind of compost that I make, and that would keep me from growing the kind of garden that I want to grow. So I'm actually feeding my employees here. The turkeys, the goats, the chickens, they all contribute. Rascal contributes. He keeps all of the crickets away and the mice and stuff. So we all do our job around here. Now I'm going to be sending some of these in with Mike to take to the guys and girls at Walmart so that they can enjoy some homegrown organic vegetables. Oops, I think I got that one in their water bowl. Ah, it's time to play bobbing for tomatoes. But today's episode is just a few different kinds of seeds that I'm going to save, and I thought I'd have you join along because it's very, very simple and it'll save you some money and it's kind of fun as well. I really do. Oh, I got one. I'm getting good at that. I should go to the carnival and do that ring toss. I'm pretty good at getting tomatoes in a water container, and the chickens really don't mind. The turkeys, they just stomp around in the water until they can find it, and then they pick it up. But as I was saying, today is seed saving episode, and I thought I'd show you how I save my seeds. So in case you're curious, or you've never really thought about it, maybe you might want to save seeds, because each year, I'm going to wipe this on my pants. Yep. I'm going to get dirty by the end of the episode. Each year we go to either the online stores, or we go to the grocery stores, or we go to Walmart, we go to, you know, any kind of store, the greenhouses, and we buy our seeds. That's money. You know, and a dollar something, two something for a pack of seeds, that's kind of ridiculous. If we have a vegetable, he's on guard. When we have a vegetable that we really, really like, we can actually save seeds from it, and it's so simple. And then the next year, when you have all of these seeds and you don't have to buy them, for one, it's a money saver. Two, you know where these seeds came from. You know that if you're worried about genetic modification, you know that these weren't genetically modified. If you're worried about hybrid, if you're growing heirlooms, you know that these aren't hybrid. They haven't crossed with anything. You know that they were grown in good quality soil. So you have control, a little bit more control over what you're doing in your garden. So aside from the seed saving, you get the aspect of knowing that you have good quality seeds. And it's actually kind of fun. You get a few people around here, grab yourself a Diet Coke. And yes, folks, this is a Diet Coke. It isn't a beer. I don't drink alcohol. Grab yourself a soda, sit outside where the birds are singing, the sun is shining. Enjoy your day. And This is one of the best parts of the year for me because it's a beautiful day. It's in the low 70s. There's a gentle breeze blowing. The birds are singing. Something is in bloom. Don't know what it is. Maybe it's rascal. I have no idea. But something smells really good out here, and I'm enjoying that. So anyway, let's get on with this, and I'll show you how I save seeds, okay? Have a seat right over here, and let's get started. It's very simple. Take a sharp knife. Very carefully, I slice across in here. Now you can slice the top off, you can slice it directly in half. There is no right or wrong way to do it. I have just found through experience that doing the cross makes it easier because it cuts it into four sections and cuts through the goo. And then when you squeeze it, it just flows right on out like this. And it gets out practically all the seeds this way instead of having any section inside that still has seeds. See how that works? You got a little starfish after you're done. Now you can toss this into a bowl, toss all these into a bowl and have them for dinner, salad, cooking. They're still perfectly good to eat. The only thing is you don't have the goo and you don't have the seeds. And if you're me, that's absolutely perfect because the flesh of the tomato is my absolute favorite part. And I do want to save the seeds. So I'm gonna toss this to the chicken, see if I can hit a chicken. Bingo. Done deal. What we're left over with is this. Let me see if I can block the sun so that you can see inside. Well, okay, that's not working. Well, you can kind of see the goo inside with all the seeds. See? By the time I'm done with all of these, this cup is going to be pretty much full of goo and seeds. The way that we save seeds for tomatoes is very simple. Now, by the way, if you want to just save seeds from a few tomatoes, you can take a paper towel and all you have to do is slice this. Open it up. Oh, I don't have a paper towel. Oh, yes I do, as a matter of fact. Well, I'm all full of props today, aren't I? I've done this in another episode, but I'm gonna demonstrate it again because I just happen to have you here. Open the tomato up, press it down, squeeze, and then just run it from left to right. And there you have it. You have seeds on your paper towel. What you're gonna do is take this, set it in a sunny window, let it set for a few days, maybe 2 to 3 days. What it's going to do is dry all of these and glue them onto the paper towel. You take the dried paper towel with the dried seeds and toss it in a Ziploc baggie or any kind of container with a lid to keep the dust and keep bugs out of it. Store it in a cool, dry place over the winter. Then in the spring, you're going to take this, pretend that this is the dried paper towel. You're just going to break off a piece with a couple seeds on it. And if you start them in cups like I do, you fill the cup full of soil, you put this in there, and then you cover it up with about a half inch full of soil. You water the soil. What this does is the paper towel draws the moisture to the seed and keeps it moisture, because sometimes you may have like a peat moss based potting soil, and that tends to, you know, have you ever had that? You know, you put water in there and it kind of runs off and stuff. With the paper towel, it draws the moisture to the seed and holds it on the seed and keeps it moisture longer, which helps with the germination. So there's the germination tip for you. And the paper towel will eventually dissolve. It doesn't hinder the roots or anything like that. It'll break down, and there you go. That's how you save a few seeds on a paper towel. When I'm saving lots of seeds, I like to do it this way because this is called the fermentation method. You fill this full of seeds, you let it set out for the rest of the day, open to the air. And then you take a paper towel and you put it over the top, form it over there, and you can use a rubber band if you want. I just put it like this. Keep it out of a sunny window. Do not put it in the sun. Just set this on the counter out of the way in the shade, and what'll happen is, hey, I got a prop over here. I did these a few days ago. Take a look inside this cup. This is what you're gonna see after 3 days. You're gonna see this crust of mold on top. It's gonna look really disgusting and it's gonna smell like fermented seeds. Really gross. That is absolutely perfect. You're gonna wanna let this set from the time that you put the seeds in there until the time that it's moldy. It'll take about maybe, I'd say 4 days. 4 days is perfect and you're gonna have this. Now let me show you what the next step is. Here we go with step number two. I'm doing this outside, but generally I would just do this underneath the faucet in the house. But a lot of people have chlorinated water, and I don't know how chlorinated water is gonna affect these, so I'm using my well water with my hose. You just gently Well, okay, maybe not so gently. And it doesn't matter if it stirs it up. Actually, that's what you want to do. Fill up the cup with water. Now, by the way, if you have a full cup of these seeds like I have over there, you're going to want to dump it into a larger container before you do this. You fill it full of water so that it's about maybe, I don't know, 5 times more water than you have seeds. Now what you're going to want to do is watch closely and gently pour out the liquid. Don't pour it out fast, because what happens is after fermenting, the seeds will drop down to the bottom. Before they ferment, it's this thick goo that holds on to the seeds. The fermentation breaks this down into a liquid, then the seeds fall down to the bottom. Now, there's something about the goo, I think it's a chemical possibly in there, that keeps the seeds from germinating, so you don't have to worry about them germinating while they're fermenting. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to pour this out. Now, you don't want to pour it all out. You want to pour about maybe half of it out, and then you add in more water. This cleans off the seeds is what we're doing. It's cleaning off the seeds. It's getting rid of all the gunk. You put the water in, give it about maybe 30 seconds for the seeds to settle down to the bottom. They do fall pretty quick. And then we pour it off again. This is just a process. Now, pour it nice and slow. Take your time. There is no rush, and you don't want to lose any seeds. If you see the seeds starting to come to the side, you stop pouring and add more water. And you do this a few times. Oh, I can hear that cat. You hear the chickens? Yep. That cat's in the chicken coop. And the cat's not doing anything. The cat's just there, existing. And the chickens just don't like it. They don't like anything. But I really don't care what they like. The cat's not hurting them. The cat's just living in the barn. Maybe eventually it'll come around and I can be able to get close to it and feed it. And it'll be a barn cat and keep the mice down. But it's not harming the chickens, so I really don't care. Anyway, back to our seed saving. You want to do this until the water is clear. It's only going to take a few times. And if there's a little piece of tomato in there, don't even worry about that. You can pluck it out with your finger. Now see, the water's getting clearer. We're going to pour this out. There goes a little piece of tomato. And a couple seeds might float out. Generally, the seeds that are going to float on the top aren't good anyway. So you do want to get rid of those. Those are bad seeds. Good seeds sink, bad seeds float. Now you just hold it level. Don't be tempted to dump it upside down, or a big clump of seeds are going to fall into your sink. Let it drip like that, and then look at what we have here. That is a lot of seeds. And that's just from a handful of tomatoes. The ones that I have over there are going to produce about 10 times as many seeds. Now what I do is I take a piece of cardboard. At one time I said use a styrofoam plate, but I really got reamed by people for using styrofoam, which is not environmentally friendly. And I understand that and I appreciate that. So now I've changed my way. Oh, well, when you're outside, you get all kinds of weird stuff on you. Anyway, now I use old cardboard from boxes that I'm going to throw away or break down. So do this. Thunk, 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 thunk. And voila. Almost every single seed comes up. You take your fingers and spread these out nice and thin so that there's not any deep clumps, okay? And the cardboard will absorb some of the water. But the next step that you want to do, as soon as you spread these out nice and thin, and I used to use a dehydrator to dry these seeds. You want to dry them out relatively quickly. You don't want them to stay moist for a few days. Now you can do this easily by spreading them out like this, and then inside put them on the windowsill of a sunny window, or if it's not breezy outside, set them out on a picnic table in the sun, and after a few hours they're going to be dry. Then you can set them in a sunny window inside and let them set there for a couple days. You want to let them dry for a couple days, because even though they may look dry on the outside, they're still a little moist on the inside. And the key to successfully storing these seeds is to make sure they're very, very dry. So I say leave it out into the weather for about a couple days. Don't let them get moist again for a couple days, and then you're going to end up with this dried crust of seeds. You just gently scrape them, then take your fingers and then sift through them, put them in a plastic baggie or any other kind of airtight container, store them in a cool, dry place, and you have seeds for everybody. You not only have enough seeds for yourself, you have enough seeds to share with your friends, your family, give some to your kids, take them to the teachers in school, and maybe the teacher can pass them out to other students, and they can take them home to their family and share what you grew in your garden. And that is like the wonder that I think is gardening, that you have so much that you can absolutely share, and you can help other people grow their own vegetables. That's a lot of seeds. I gotta admit, that's a lot of seeds. Oh, one last thing with tomatoes, then we're gonna go on to peppers. When you're saving tomato seeds, whether it's from a cherry tomato, beefsteak, Roma, anything, I would advise waiting until the tomato is as ripe as possible, as red as it's gonna get, because the more ripe it is, the more likely it is that the seed is gonna be viable. The seed matures as the fruit matures. And also, you wanna make sure that you get the very best specimen you can. So you wanna make sure that you get, like if you're doing beefsteaks, you want a nice, red, ripe, round one. You want a good size one. You don't wanna get the runt of the litter. You don't wanna get some odd shape in one, or one that doesn't look quite right. You wanna make sure that the genetics in this are the best that you could possibly get. So, well, when it comes to cherry tomatoes, it really doesn't matter because they can be small. But with beefsteaks, you wanna really pick and choose, okay? Save only the seeds from the ones that you think are the best looking, and that way you'll pass on the best genetics. This one, this is a pepper, and it's called the Yellow Monster. This is a beautiful one. These were featured in last week's video, and I really do like these. The smell, the flavor, the look, the fun of growing them. This is a very prolific pepper plant, and I took the best looking Yellow Monster that I had, and I believe this is what they look like when they're ripe. I don't know if they turn red. All I know is that they're called Yellow Monster, so I'm assuming that yellow is the pepper when they're the ripest. This one right here is called an Anaheim. This is a very popular variety. These are great for stuffing, for grilling, and you put these on a grill and they smell absolutely fantastic. What the heck was that? When you fart? Oh, that's an odd sound. Coming out of one of them, it's either the bird or the goat. One of the two. Welcome to the farm. Unscripted gas. Anyway, we're just going to continue with this. I'm not going to cut that out. We're going to continue, and I'm going to show you how to save pepper seeds. Very easy. First of all, you want to make sure that you get a good, just like the tomatoes, a good large specimen. You want to make sure it's perfectly ripe, and it's better to let these ripen on the plant than to ripen off the plant. I just think it's better that way. Anyway, this is a Yellow Monster, very prolific. This is an Anaheim. The Anaheim turns red when it's perfectly ripe. A lot of peppers will turn red. So I got two very ripe specimens. Come on in, and I'm gonna slice into them, and I'm gonna show you how I save seeds. My way is to not slice the whole cap off. Just take a sharp knife, take it in there, and go around the perimeter. I guess the best way to do it would be to keep your finger here so you don't go in too deep. Just slice around the perimeter. Now, I'm assuming that you might want to stuff these, otherwise I would just slice right down the center. So I'm doing this. I'm just taking it around the sides, and then I pop this out. Generally, this will take a lot of the seeds with it. And you got the cap right here. Now, I'm going to take this off because I don't want any of the pepper to be on there. Plus, I'm going to eat the pepper. I'm a little greedy. But you don't want the pepper to be on there because sometimes the pepper will hold a lot of moisture and it can rot. You want to dry the seeds. You don't want to have pepper spreading any kind of mold or fungus onto these seeds. Pepper seeds are a little bit more touchy than tomato seeds. Those of you that have... I got to try this. Oh. Tangy. I like this. Yellow Monster, folks. Let me tell you something. Green peppers have a very good flavor, but when you take these peppers and you let them ripen until they're full color, there's a sweetness in those that you just cannot get with green peppers. Now look at this on the inside. This is perfect for stuffing, isn't it? Yep. So anyway, I'm going to set this to the side and not pig out right in front of you. Now, when I save peppers, you can do it one or two ways. You can leave it on what's called the placenta, which is the spongy part right here, or you can knock the seeds off, however you want to do it. I prefer to knock them off because sometimes mold will get on this placenta, and once mold starts, it spreads to the seeds. So what I'm going to do is I just do this right on top of the cardboard, Yeah, they're going to be popping all over the place. Sometimes it's like popcorn, they go flying. And boy, do I have flies out here today. I guess they like it when I save seeds. Now, this is just from one pepper. Now, generally, you're not going to need a whole lot of seeds because, I mean, come on. How many pepper plants are we going to be growing? Anyway, you want to spread these out. Now, cardboard, of course, is best. I recommend that when you save the tomato seeds, do not put them on a paper towel when you're drying them out like this, you know, the bulk seeds, because what's going to happen is they're going to stick to the paper towel. Cardboard is best because then you can scrape them off the cardboard. You could toss the cardboard, or you can compost it, or you can save it for another year. And you get them free with a box anyway. Spread these out. Set them in a non-windy place, because these will blow all over the place. Set them in a warm, sunny location. Let them dry out for a few hours or so, and then take them inside and let them dry for, I'd say, about a week, okay? A little bit longer than tomato seeds. Let them dry for about a week. Make sure they're bone dry, because this is from my personal experience. This is not a scientific thing. In my experience, if these don't dry properly, they do tend to rot. And if you've ever dried pepper seeds, sometimes you may notice that the seeds will get dark brown or almost black. Well, in my experience, that's because the pepper either was defective with a little bit of rot inside, or most likely it wasn't ripe. You do not want to save seeds from an unripe pepper. The riper, the better. So make sure it ripens on the plant and it's full color, whatever color that pepper's supposed to be. Then you put them on here, you dry them out. A very good seed is supposed to be light yellow to a light golden color. If it's any other color besides that, there's a very good chance that you don't have good seeds. So save a lot of them, and hopefully you'll get some that are good. That's what it looks like with the yellow monster. Now I'm going to set these off to the side. There we go. Now let's go into the Anaheim, okay? I'm going to do the exact same thing to the Anaheim. I'm going to slice in like this. Now you want to make sure that you're very careful, okay? I've actually cut myself before, so don't feel bad if you do. Well, actually, feel bad that you cut yourself, but don't feel stupid, because we all make mistakes. And I'm sure there are better ways to do this, but you know me, this is just my way of doing things. Let's pop off a little head and see what's inside. Now, of course, I'm going to try and keep these separated. And by the way, these plants were grown so close together, there's a very good chance that they cross-pollinated. And if you don't want your peppers to cross-pollinate, you might want to plant them a few hundred feet apart, because bees and other pollinating insects, they'll go from plant to plant. And from what I understand, I think it's a few hundred feet. And that's a long way. That's clear across your property line. And I just don't have that luxury. So more than likely, my plants cross-pollinate. But you know what? I don't care, because this is a fantastic pepper. This is a fantastic pepper. So what if they had a baby? If they had a baby, I'm going to get the best of both worlds. So it doesn't really matter to me if they cross-pollinate, but I don't want to mix up the seeds, because when I'm planting seeds, I don't want to plant all of this and none of that. So I'm going to try and keep these seeds separate, but I wanted to just show you. This is for a demo only. Now, if I were going to save seeds, I wouldn't do them both together like this. You definitely don't want to do that. And you want to write it down on the cardboard which seed you have. That way you're not sitting around next year going, darn it, what is that? I don't know what that was. I know I saved the seeds, but I don't know what it was from. And there we go. Anaheim pepper seeds. Same way that you're going to dry these off, you want to dry those off. You don't want to stack them. You want to spread them out and make sure they're bone dry, then put them in an airtight container. That's all there is to it. Okay, this is getting funner and funner, isn't it? This right here, this beauty, these are not cherry tomatoes. This is an asparagus fern. And those of you that like asparagus, you grow an asparagus bed and then you get these little spears, you know, and they're really delicious in the spring. Well, you let some of them grow up because you want the plant to put energy back into the roots for next year. It's an investment. So you let a lot of the ferns grow up. What'll happen on some of them is they'll form these berries. And the berries start out as green, then they turn a yellowish color, then they turn red. When they're red, they're ripe. If you ever want to start more asparagus plants, you can do them from these berries. And I'm going to show you how, okay? And I have done them from seeds, and they grew extremely well. I did this when I was up at Windham. I grew them indoors in the winter in little cups. And then when spring came, I planted them out in the garden, and they did fantastic. The next year, the very next year, I was harvesting asparagus spears from them. So it gives them a great head start, and you know that you're getting something like with these, something healthy, something that was grown the way that you want it to grow, and it's very easy to do. It's very, very simple. This isn't going to take long at all. Come over here and let's play the shell game with these little peas, okay? Your asparagus plant is going to put out these little green berries, see, like this. Now you don't want to harvest them when they're green like that. You want to wait until they look like this, until they look like a little tiny cherry, okay? Then you pop those off of your plant, take them in your hand, squeeze them, and then what'll happen is you're going to get these black seeds. I already had some in my hand, but see? Then you just take the gooey part, toss it away, and don't worry, these aren't poisonous or anything. They probably taste like crud, but they're not poisonous. People confuse asparagus plants with the asparagus plants, asparagus ferns that you can buy in the store, which is an indoor house plant. Asparagus ferns, which are the indoor house plant, totally poisonous, top to toe. You don't want to be eating those things. Asparagus ferns are not. That's what we have here. The asparagus plants that you grow in your garden, these are not poisonous, although you probably don't want to eat these things because they taste awful. Now you just flick the goo off your fingers. Take these seeds, dry them out just like you do any other seeds, store them in a cool, dry place, and you can plant these in the, well, I plant these in the middle of the winter to get new plants for my garden for the spring. Yeah. There flies on everything. Yeah, go away. Go eat something else. I think we're pretty much done. That's it. That's my seed saving episode. There are so many different plants that you can save seeds from. Basically everything in your garden, from eggplants, tomatoes, peppers, strawberries. There's a million different ways that you can save seeds. And I've done a couple episodes on saving pea seeds, bean seeds, and it was a few years ago. But these are just the ones that I have available right now. You can save all different kinds of seeds. You can save yourself money. It's kind of fun. It's a nice way to spend the day, to get outside, enjoy the sun, and kitty. Can you see past? Oh, no, he ran. Yeah, Rascal found the kitty. Where's the kitty? I know, right? You want me to open up the... Yeah, he wants me to open up the coop. Let him in. I'm sorry. Yeah, I can't let you in there. You'll just chase him off. There he goes. There he goes, kitty. He just ran across there. It's a beautiful tabby. It's a yellow and white half-grown tabby. And I'm trying to be as calm as I can around it, and I don't chase it away, and I keep Rascal away from it, because eventually, possibly, it's going to calm down and realize that I'm not out to kill it. I mean, it's a feral cat, and I want it to realize that this is a safe place. I know it's probably not the smartest thing in the world, but then again, somebody wasn't taking care of the cats. That's how this cat eventually, you know, came out to be wild. Somebody's cat gave birth. And I've seen a couple feral cats with kittens walking along the roads. They're just wild cats. And when they see a car coming, they dash into the weeds. They know, you know, they're acclimated to this environment. I want this cat to try to feel like it's at home. So maybe eventually, I don't think it'll ever come up to me, but maybe eventually I can put a bowl of food up on a ledge where the chickens can't get to it and start feeding it in the chicken coop. And that way this winter, it'll learn to stay in the chicken coop, keep the mice down, it can be kept company by the birds, and it's going to be perfectly safe. That's the best I can do. Anyway, back to the seed saving. Thank you everybody for joining me. I really do appreciate it. If you have any questions concerning saving seeds or anything garden related or any question whatsoever, please feel free to post it in the comment section below. I will do my very best to give you the very best answer I possibly can. I got that. I can say that pretty fast, can't I? Okay, thank you everybody. Have a great day. Okay, time to gather up stuff. Asparagus stinks. Asparagus berries actually stink. I don't much care for that smell. Son of a gun.